Get ready. Get ready. One more time. Get ready. It's Let's Talk Business with Cheryl Jennings Cousseau. Woohoo! It's the fourth hour of the month, and this month is Black History Month. That's the month that was given to us, but we celebrate Black History every day. I'm here with my co-host, Diva.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us.
I said to El Diva, I said to our special guest, and you guys are going to, for those of you that's on Facebook, you already know who the guest is. And I said to our guest that we were going to talk a couple of minutes about fashion. And look at this fashionista over here. So we want to give a shout out to, as a matter of fact, my outfit is from right here on the campus of 5508 Accent Styles Boutique.
Hey, Angie!
Yes, and so you know all that we have on is certainly something to support our Black-owned businesses. So shout out to all of the businesses here on the campus of 5508. And El Diva, I must tell you, the wrap that I have on,
yes, ma'am.
Another Black-owned business. She's actually outside of Orlando. Onesie, and it's the onesie wrap. One of the things I love about her wrap, it comes in three different pieces. So this is the blossoming flower, or you have the rosebud. There are three different attachments that you can put on your wrap, and it comes with bands, elastic, and she has a video tutorial for those that don't quite know how to hook it up, or you just do your own thing.
Well, hey! I must say you're looking magnificent, Queen Diva, as ever.
Well, thank you. And I'm looking forward to the piece that you have. So in celebration of Black History Month, you've brought a new line to your business. So tell us a little bit about that, and then we'll get into the real history.
Okay. Well, of course, I'm wearing an El Diva exclusive as well.
Yes, you are. Ooh, I love the animal print.
Yes. So I have that, as well as our... Can you see my necklace there? And then let me take a pair of these earrings off so you can see our earrings as well. We're representing all month long.
Oh, I love that.
Yes, the mothership. Hey, the mothership.
That's beautiful.
The map. Yeah, of course.
Now, can you reverse that earring?
Well, you know, they can be black.
Okay,
you know,
because that's the part I saw. Was
right.
The black.
Just the shape of the continent of Africa. Or we
beautiful.
Can show the continent along with our queen there as well.
Yes,
so. These are all exclusive El Diva, of course. And yes, for Black History Month, we decided that we're going to do something extra special and we're going to add something to our line. So we added our mouse pads so that you can represent all
Isn't
year
that
long.
Beautiful?
This is our Fix Your Crown mouse pad.
Fix Your Crown.
Fix Your Crown, you ladies. Yes.
Listen, ladies or gentlemen, because someone will actually get to win one of these beautiful Afrocentric mouse pads. So towards the end of the show, you'll let us know. They'll call in. It is a call-in show, 813-444-9588. So remember that later. So that's the first one.
That's Fix My Crown. Okay. Yes. And this is all our exceptional women. And it has Michelle Obama in the center. And of course, you know,
that.
We have earrings that match this too.
Oh, you do? So I have the purse.
Yeah. Purses. You have a purse like this one.
Similar to that one.
Okay. Wow.
Michelle.
Yeah. We carry the Michelle Obama purses as well. And we have these exact earrings as well. So
beautiful. That's
one of our mouse pads. And then we have our African Dancing Ladies mouse pad.
Love it.
And then we have our Clench Your Pearls mouse pad.
Beautiful.
So we have four styles that are available right now, and we're going to be adding more. But of course, we're giving one away today. So call in, and Queen will let you know when we'll be giving them away. Okay.
All right. Well, listen, all that being said, because, you know, we have to talk about fashion. The fourth hour of the show is usually about fashion, food, finance, and other fun things that we do.
Yes.
By the way, I like the glasses.
Oh.
Is that part of your line?
No, it's not.
Okay.
These are things that I need, you know, I'm over 50, you need them now.
Listen, this is how I'm going to introduce our guests. I was thinking about this. Oh, we have a call. We have a call.
The caller already? All right.
I didn't even get to introduce our special guest. Caller, you're on Let's Talk Business with Cheryl J. Cousseau. Who do we have online?
Yeah, this is DJ CEO. Can I wear that mouse pad?
Face Tampa Bay Tammy. Your husband is off the chain. He just called into the show. He is not eligible. Oh my goodness. I'm with you. When I saw them, I was like, I can't even make up my mind. And so, but that being said, let's take a moment. And he had us so ready, and I'm inviting the caller.
We had a vibe caller.
El Diva, pull your wires down so they won't be. From the back.
Yes.
So
okay.
This is how I want to introduce our special guest. I'm gonna get his copy, because when I say special, when we talk about Black History Month, listen, there's a lot. Can you put it all into 1 hour? Absolutely not. So here you have it. And what I'm reading is something that each of you can go and see for yourself. If you're on Facebook and you got the notice last night, you know who our guest is. Woolworth Cityan, Tampa, Florida. W.F. Woolworth Store. I don't know, Dara. You may not have remembered that store. What year did you come here?
86, but we had Woolworth in Memphis.
Okay, so you know what Woolworth's all about. Woolworth's Variety Store was a scene of a pivotal event that started on February 29th, 1960. That's Saturday, y'all.
Wow.
1960. Dara says he was 4, and my co-host, Dr. Shanae Davis, was here. We were not born, but all thanks be to God, I was. Clarence Fort, president of the NAACP Youth Council, and the Reverend A. Leon Laurie, NAACP state president, led about 40 students from George S. Middleton and Howard W. Blake High Schools in a peaceful sit-in at W.F. Woolworth's lunch counter at 801 North Franklin Street. That's downtown Tampa. At the time, Tampa Mayor Julian B. Lane assigned police to escort the young protesters. And after about a week, Lane agreed to appoint a biracial committee to look into the demonstrators' complaints. By September, Tampa's lunch counters were integrated without the violent scene in many other parts of the country. You can go to 801 Franklin Street and see this historical marker. This week, February 29th, which is Saturday, this event is 60 years old.
Wow.
To In Touch News viewers, to our Facebook listeners, to those that support Let's Talk Business with SJC, our guest today is none other than Clarence Fort, civil rights trailblazer.
Yes.
Of the Woolworth City.
Woo!
Ladies and gentlemen, there he is. Before he speaks, Mr. Fort, we have a call. Caller, come in, and thank you so much for holding. Is this a real call?
Hello.
Or is this Tampa Bay Tammy? Hello, caller. Your name, please?
My name's Alana Cousseau.
Oh, my God. Deacon Fort, Alana Cousseau now lives in, is it North or South Dakota, girl?
In North Dakota.
North Dakota. I know.
Wow.
She needs to have her temperature checked. What a pleasant surprise, Alana. Do you know this civil rights trailblazer?
I do, and he paved the way for so many of us growing up. It was an honor to even call in to acknowledge him.
A lot of people,
yes, a lot of people often wonder why I know so much about, Black history and why I'm so integrated with what's going on in different locations around the United States. And it's because of him.
Wow,
attending New Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church and him initiating the Saving Our Children's program, it enlightened me at an early age about different landmarks and just different things and different people. And I'll never forget that. Like, he created a huge legacy, not only in Tampa, but for our community as well. And just as a young generation, and I believe about, I'm not sure how many generations were before or after me, but he made a big, 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 big impact in not only my life, but several hundreds of other lives.
Several hundreds of others. Thank you so much. What a way to render a tribute. And let's ask Mr. Fort. I call him Deacon Fort, y'all. Mr. Fort, how old was that program or that she's talking about? And to our Facebook family, if you go to In Touch News, you'll be able to hear the callers coming in and see the show and see all of the guests. But for those, we know if you're looking at us on Facebook, the caller is Alana Cusso. She's calling in and paying homage to Mr. Fort about being a trailblazer and leaving a legacy in a program that she participated in as a youth, and it was called Saving Our Children.
Yes, it was 30 years old.
Oh, my gosh, 30 years
and
ago.
And what happened, we started out with a few kids, and we had it every Saturday morning from 9:30 to 11:30. And actually, at the end of the summer, the kids were rewarded with a trip.
Okay.
And we took some very important trips from Little Rock, Arkansas to New York City.
My goodness.
We flew, I'll never forget, 30 youngsters to New York. We took about 35 on the train to Washington, D.C., and all of the sites around Washington, D.C. So we just had a great time. And I remember Alana and her brother, Yannick.
One of the things
that was so important, we also went to the National Baptist Deacons Convention every year.
Yes.
And every year we had an oratorical contest.
Oh, goodness gracious.
And it was absolutely awesome. Alana was one of our winners, her brother Yannick. And out of 12 years and going to the convention, we have 11 first place.
Wow.
And one second.
Wow.
We never really lost.
That's awesome. That is amazing.
Did you hear that, Alana?
Of course, I'm a winner.
You're still winning. So those oratorical skills that you were taught through the Saturday Saving Our Children program resonates with you even today. So thank you.
Yes, it does. Yes,
thank
it
you.
Does.
So what a pleasant surprise to me. To,
and thank you to Mr. Deacon Clarence Fort.
That's just one
imprint that he's left as his legacy. That's just one imprint. He's done so many things.
Well, Alana, before you leave, he talked about these pivotal trips. What would have been your favorite trip over there? Because you were part of that program from like first grade to 12th grade, right? Or before first grade.
Yes, I was. But the thing about it, what correlates with it is the program actually initiated me becoming an entrepreneur. Because I would have to, I would want spending funds on my summer trip.
I remember
trip.
That, the business plan.
So they taught us about, the business plans and accounting and budgeting. And that's when I started baking cakes. So it was because of him and his program that allowed me to become an entrepreneur. So that's why I felt the need, take the time out of my schedule and just acknowledge him for just a moment, because it's deeper than just the program.
Absolutely.
So.
And life-changing, life-changing.
Life-changing for sure.
Thank you so much.
My favorite trip would probably be when we went to Atlanta, to answer your question.
Okay.
Atlanta. Okay.
What did y'all do in Atlanta? Don't even say it.
Mom wants to know.
Yeah, what happened in Atlanta? Oh, your dad and I went to the Atlanta trip. That's when you all toured the ML King hometown, the church.
Exactly.
Oh, the
we
home.
Worship at Ebenezer Baptist Church.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes,
absolutely.
That's a great
experience. Railroad, I believe. Yeah. Don't quote me. But we went a lot of places. We targeted a lot of landmarks on that one trip.
As a matter of fact, I taught the etiquette class, and they took you all to dinner for a four-course meal so that you could use what you learned in the etiquette class at a formal dinner. That was in Atlanta as well.
We know you're Wikipedia, so you have all the
Well, thank you so much. Love you. God
You're
bless
welcome.
You. What a pleasant surprise. And have an amazing day, Alana.
Thanks for calling
you
in.
Too.
Yes.
Thank
you so much
Bye-bye.
For calling in. To,
love
to
you too,
I hope I can get through the rest of this show.
Hey, she said, thank you. I love you, Mom.
Love you too, baby girl. You're going to have to go online and buy that mouse pad, though. I got my name on four. I don't know which one. They're all absolutely beautiful. So, Deacon Ford, wow, man. Hearing that from Alana, she talked about a few hundred kids. Do you even know how many kids came through the Saving Our Children program? Oh.
I think we had, over the years, about 400 kids that came
wow,
through.
Wow, that's
goodness.
Amazing.
One of the things we try to do every year is take a trip and visit different businesses, African-American
right.
businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And they really learned from those trips. It was really a beautiful thing.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. Well, that call caught us off guard, but it is a call-in show, so we thank you so much. We're going to take a break, and we'll be back after the break so that we can learn more about the man, Clarence Ford, and his personal life, and then we'll talk about other aspects of his life as well. Back after the break.
Hi, this is Nancy Jacobs, and I'm running for County Court Judge. As you celebrate Black History Month, take the time to remember your own achievements and those close to you. Everyone's contribution makes a difference, and I want to make a difference too. That's why I'm running for judge. I'm Nancy Jacobs. I'm running for County Court Judge. Vote for me.
Ray Williams Funeral Home, providing the highest quality, professional, and caring service for your family. Call Jeffrey Rhodes at 813-253-3419. That's 813-253-3419. Or visit him at 301 North Howard Avenue, Tampa, Florida. Ray Williams Funeral Home, for the finest care and quality service.
Who doesn't love being number one? When your team's dominating the standings, or your favorite band rocks the charts at number one, it feels good, right? Kind of like how it feels when you have auto insurance with State Farm. Because making you feel like number one is an honor your local State Farm agent takes seriously. Through the good times and not so good, your State Farm agent's proud to be here to help life go right.
Call Herma White at 961-6661. That's 961-6661.
And we are back. Welcome back. Let's talk business with Dusty. Our special guest today is the Clarence Ford Civil Rights Trailblazer. We want to take you back, Mr. Ford. We want to take you back to February, maybe a little before that, because let's first get to know you, the man. Who is Clarence Ford? And where are you from?
Well, I graduated from high school in 1956, Alachua County, from a town called Hawthorne, which was 11 miles east of Gainesville.
Yeah, that's the coast.
Oh, okay. And, that's here in Florida.
Here in Florida.
Yeah. Okay, good.
After high school, I went to Orlando and worked a year at the Angerville Pharmacy.
Oh, okay.
Saved up some funds, and I went to Tyler, Texas, to Barber College.
Oh, okay.
I'm in Tyler, Texas for 12 months. From there, I came back to Tampa and started my own business and my own barbershop.
That was a long ways to travel to go to a barber school.
Yeah, but it was the best in the country.
He went to the best. The best.
I went to the best.
When the best will do.
I went to the best.
So you get your barber's license. Do you come back to Tampa or Gainesville?
I came back to Tampa, and I started cutting hair in Stone's Barbershop. On 29th Street.
Remember Stone's Funeral Home?
Stone's Barbershop.
Barbershop?
Stone Barbershop on 29th Street.
All right, giving us some history today.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then I started looking around at some of the things that we needed to do to help change Tampa. So came up with the idea of the sit-in demonstrations and also with the Tampa Transit bus lines. A lot of people don't know that. But I wrote a letter at the time. They had no African-American bus drivers. And but 80% of the riders was African American. So I got with Robert Saunders, who was the field secretary at NAACP.
Yeah.
And
the late Robert.
Yeah. Drafted a letter to Tampa Transit Lines, and tell them we were going to boycott the buses if they didn't have African-American drivers.
Wow. Wait, let's back up for a second. So you finish in Barber College. You mm-hmm. come back here. Mm-hmm. Something had to have happened or something was just in you, as our grandparents say. It's just in them. were you active? Were you political in school or in high school? Where did this come about?
No more than the president of the junior senior class.
Oh, no more than that. The president of the senior class. Yeah, okay, so right. Now I kind of see where some of this is coming from.
Right.
So you came from some good stuff. You were making a difference all the way back to
high school. Yes, he was a leader back then.
Right.
So that's where that's coming from. So you come here, you can recognize that some things need to happen. You sent this letter. What happened after the letter?
Well, we got a letter back from Tampa Transit and told us to send two truck drivers at the time because we had no bus driver experience. So they had one young man working in the garage that was moving buses around. It's by the name of Robert Moore. So they hired him and they hired one other guy. So we did it sort of mushroom from that.
No,
okay. And that was a sight to really see.
Now, were you a bus driver?
Later on. I actually went with them in 1958. And my reason for going with them, I wanted to drive Trailways. I had to go to my Trailways bus station.
Okay.
Wow.
Get this, 7 times before they gave me an application.
Mm.
So I became the first African-American driver in Florida for Trailways.
Oh, good Lord.
Yeah. In Florida. Did you say Florida?
In Florida.
The first
state.
In Florida. Wow.
First in whole state.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Now, this is history.
That is, definitely.
Talk about Black History Month. What do you think?
First in Florida. Yes. First in Florida. Hey,
president of the senior class, junior senior class, from a little town, Hawthorne. I think that's like right outside of Gainesville.
Yes, yes.
And then you come here, you see injustices, but you do something.
Yes.
You write a letter.
Right.
I wonder how long did it take for that letter to come back answered to you?
I think it was about 7 months.
Oh, I knew it was a long time.
7 months. Wow.
I wouldn't have thought that long, though.
I was cutting hair, and one of the dispatchers came out of the barbershop and asked if I was still interested in driving bus railways. And I told him, yes, I was. So I had to go to Miami for an 8-hour interview. 8 hours.
Oh, an 8-hour interview.
Wow. At the time, I was married to Yvonne, my wife, and they interviewed her for 4 hours.
Wow. Oh my goodness. The spouse has to be interviewed as well.
Had to be interviewed, right?
Wow, that's amazing.
They wanted to know that, your standings, because being a bus driver, you were going to meet all types of people. So that's what happened.
You didn't have to go through all of that to become a deacon at the church.
No.
My goodness.
But it was well worth it. Trust
me. Then, do you remember what year that was? Because I'm looking at this. So the sit-in, you're 21 years old, mm-hmm. and this is February 29th, 1960.
Mm-hmm.
Were you married? Were you single?
No, I was a single man when we had the sit-in.
Okay, you were a single man at the sit-in.
Right, right.
And so you were representing Middleton?
No.
Well, you were already out of school, 21.
I was already out. What I did, I went to the student council president at Middleton, which was George Edgecombe. And then I went to Howard W. Blake.
My goodness.
We're talking history here.
Yeah, and I had them to get me some students.
Okay.
But we didn't tell them what we were going to do. We only told them to meet us at the church over on Harrison Street. And we just told them to follow the lead, and we marched downtown.
Just like that.
Nobody had money
you,
but
you
me.
You hear some Hamlin stuff coming out.
So
Hamlin
they had served us. They couldn't have bought anything, really.
Wow. What church did you meet at?
It was on Harrison Street, St. Paul AME Church.
Oh, AME.
Shout out to
St. Paul AME.
AME.
Yes.
Well, Mr. Foote, we have a call on the line. Caller, come in.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Thank you so much for calling. This is Let's Talk Business with SJC. Who do we have online?
You have Betty Gibbs Jennings.
That's my classmate.
That's his classmate. He said, "Okay, yes.
we have been caught off guard today."
Yes.
Mrs. Betty Gibbs Jennings.
Hello.
Thank you so much for calling. So you know this young man, Clarence Fort.
I certainly do. We met in elementary school.
Elementary school? Right. Oh, my goodness.
Wow. They go way back
I'm
there.
I'm so proud of him.
You're so, she says she's so proud of
Thank
you.
Thank you, Betty. Thank you. Don't tell our ages.
Wow. Oh, I won't.
She says it's too late. You met in elementary. Yeah. You were 21 in 1960. We can do the math. Now, Mrs. Jennings, you're from Hawthorne?
Yes, I am.
Wow, okay.
Wow, elementary school. So what do you remember about this guy? I was just asking him, where did this whole leadership piece come from? Do you remember him as a leader? No, you all met in elementary school.
Yes, but he was always up front. He was always a leader. We always selected him as a leader of our class. He was president of our class.
Oh, my goodness.
From 7th through 12th grade.
Ooh, really? Y'all elected him every year. This was like a 4-year term. He did a pretty good job.
A great young man.
It sounds like some good stuff came out of Hawthorne.
That's right. Some of the best stuff you've ever heard of.
Best stock.
Oh, well, my gosh. So you remember him being a leader. Have you kept in touch? Do you know some of the landmarks, accomplishments that he made as a result of the sit-ins?
Well, I think his brother played ball, and a lot of the bigger people played ball, but we were kind of short, and we didn't play ball. But we did a lot of things that a lot of the people that played ball couldn't do.
All
we
right.
were leaders, and we just led the school, and we did a lot of things that would help make Shell a school that was on the map.
And what was the name of the school, elementary school?
Well, it was Shell Elementary and Shell High School.
So the elementary was the same name. So you all stayed in the same school.
First through 12.
Oh, that was amazing.
First through 12?
First
is that
through 12.
Really?
Okay,
wow.
That was really the country. Well, my gosh.
That means they're part of the 12-year club.
Yeah, the 12-year club. I don't know if you heard our engineer over here saying y'all were part of the 12-year club.
Well, you know, that was back in the day when the instructors knew our parents.
Oh, okay.
So we couldn't do anything wrong, really. Believe me, we were well-disciplined.
Oh, my gosh. Well, I appreciate you so much calling in to share about what Mr. Fort did. And so you all ended up, you didn't do sports. So it sounds like you all went straight for academia and leadership.
That's right. In fact, his wife was my husband's classmate.
So it was.
And he was my classmate.
At
so
Middleton.
We connected that way also.
God, what a small world. Wow. I mean, you guys, I hear a book. I see a book coming. Well, we want to take the opportunity. We have so many questions to ask him today about what happened in his life from the sit-in, but to have someone call in from elementary school or, as DJ CEO say, the 12-year club.
The 12-year club.
And you all have kept in touch after all those years.
Yes. We
That's
had
just
several
beautiful.
Family reunions and... We need to have another one before the rest of us go.
Oh, well, God bless you, and may God continue to give you longevity, and we can hear more about your story. Thank you. Thank you so much
for
calling
and
in.
Congratulations, classmate.
Thank you, Betty. I appreciate that.
All right, so back to you. So I was looking at some pictures, and we're actually going to tag these pictures. We're going to tag these pictures on our thank you post because there is a marker. And I'm hoping we'll see something on the news this weekend, certainly earmarking the 60th anniversary of Woolworth sit-ins. Now, can you tell us some of the people that were with you? Do you remember some? And then from there, how has the city and or county today recognize what you all did over 60 years ago, Mr. Ford?
Well, actually, the one who really got the ball rolling was Mayor Bob Buckhorn.
Okay.
He played
Shout out to
the physical part. He was instrumental, and he and Tammy Fields in getting the
Reporter
park named
Tammy
after
Fields,
me. Yes.
News anchor.
Right.
Remember
right.
Tammy Darrell?
She's in Orlando now, I think, at Channel 9.
Okay.
But she was in Tampa for a spell.
Tammy, okay.
Tammy Fields went before the Historical Society to get the marker set up. So she played a big part in doing that.
Wow. It's a beautiful marker.
Absolutely. But I can remember going out to Middleton High School recruiting students. And the principal, he said, "Now, young man, if someone asks you what you're doing, I don't know you here, okay?"
Wow. That's the way they did
that.
It.
In those days, they could not do that. They could not do that. Same thing at Blake. When I went over to Blake, but what I did, I got with the student council presidents, and I had them to recruit students to meet us at the church, but we didn't tell them what they were going to do. And once they got there, we just told them to follow the lead. But very successful. No incidents.
I got to share this picture, y'all. This is what Mr. Ford looked like at the actual sit-in. And we do have a picture of the sit-in. But what I was asking you, this is one of the anniversary pictures, but I think this is, oh my gosh, here is the actual picture.
Original.
Oh, shout out to the Florida Sentinel who printed this article. Oh, they were doing, this was Tammy's article. And so Tammy did an article leading up to the unveiling of the marker. But I can look at this picture. And I see Clarence Ford, but who's that on the other side of you?
That's a young man who went to school at Howard W. Blake.
Okay, so you got.
And he was at the unveiling, believe it or not, when we had the marker. He was there. He was in a wheelchair there.
Wow.
Right. Okay.
He was in a wheelchair, but he was there. And
this
young lady here was there.
Okay.
Also, right. I can't remember their names, but they was at the unveiling of the marker.
And in the back is Arthenia Joyner.
Right.
The
Honorable Athena Joyner was 15 years old at the time.
15,
years old. So
well, we're really talking history here.
Yes.
We will share this picture because from this, you all have had celebratory celebrations. I've got a picture where you and Dr. Laurie, we are going to take a station break back after the moment. Back in a moment.
Join me every Monday at 7 p.m. for Jazz at Miss Connie's House, bringing you the smoothest jazz and the coolest guests right here on In Touch Radio.
Hello, I'm Rob Perry with Solar Energy Loan Fund, and we can help you finance your energy needs. If you need a new air conditioner, roof, solar panels, windows, doors, weatherization, having plumbing issues, the Solon Energy Loan Fund can help you with that. Even if your credit isn't the best, we will be able to help you replace that old air conditioner or get that roof replaced. Again, my name is Rob Perry. I'm with Solon Energy Loan Fund. I can be reached at 727-315-3223. Again, that's 727-315-3223. Looking to hear from you.
Hi, this is Trina Johnson with Coldwell Banker Real Estate, the real estate agent you've been looking for. If you want top dollar for your home or you're looking to make a purchase, call me at 813-244-6953. Again, 813-244-6953 and let me list your home.
Back. We are back. We have our special guest, Deacon Clarence Ford. And I can already say Diva, El Diva.
Yes.
There's going to be a part two.
It has to be.
There's
so much. I know. I'm waiting to ask some questions too. So I know there's so much that we want
to
know.
Let El Diva ask her questions while we have a moment. This is now the third quarter of our show. So we have one more. No, this is the. This is history. What can I say? Al Diva,
Well, Mr. Ford, thank you so much for joining us. And this is really, truly a history lesson for me and all of my Facebook friends. Your city in 1960, I believe for majority of my Facebook friends, we weren't even born then. Oh. So if you would just take us back a little bit and tell us, why were you having this sit-in? Give us a little bit of history of why the sit-in was important, why you did it.
Well, actually, we was inspired by the Greenboro, North Carolina sit-ins. I don't know if you remember the Greenboro Four.
Only reading the
they
stories.
They actually started the sit-ins around the South. And after they had their sit-ins, then I got with Reverend Laurie and our youth council and say, well, we have the same problem in Tampa. We cannot sit down and eat at a five intensive store. So that's when we got together and came up with a strategy for me to go out to the schools and recruit students at Middleton and Blake. Now, at the time, I was a young barber, so I couldn't get fired.
You were your own boss, right?
I'm my own boss. I couldn't get fired, so that's why I was more or less picked to do it. So when we went out to the campuses, and the principals knew I were there, but they kind of kept it quiet because they would have lost their jobs because you didn't just do anything like that, integration. So I sort of just made my way around campus and talked with the two presidents. And they recruited the students.
So I got a little history to share.
You got some more stuff in you?
Well, let me tell you, with the Greensboro Four, my son, who has passed on, he died at 22. Mm-hmm. But before he died, he did a documentary for the Greensboro Four.
Right.
He played Ezell Blair. So he's in the Greensboro International Civil Rights Museum in Greensboro, North Carolina. So I got to
awesome.
Do a shout out to my son,
Absolutely.
Braxton Darrell Johnson, who has passed on, but he left his legacy playing Ezell Blair of the Greensboro Four.
And now you get to interview, talk right
Absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely.
I actually
with
had
the
a chance to visit that store.
Wow.
And they have live shots. Well, not live shots, but full life shots. Pictures of those four
yes,
guys
they do.
Sitting at the lunch counter.
Yes,
wow.
they do.
And they made it out of a museum.
Yes.
Wow.
So it's
beautiful.
Really something to see.
Yeah.
Well, Al Diva, were you afraid?
Any
of the students? You had to have police escorts.
Well, they didn't really start until the second day. First day, because they didn't know we were coming.
Okay.
So the
element
second
of surprise.
Day, the second day, that's when the mayor, he sent protection to escort us downtown.
Oh, they did send protection.
To escort us downtown.
So
and that was unheard of.
Can you kind of take us back as you're walking into the store with the students? What occurs?
Well, as several of us sit down, then the white customers got up and left.
Mm.
Oh, okay.
Once they got up and left on the first day, then they cut the lights out on us.
Oh, my God.
Got all the lights out. So we walked outside. Stood around. We didn't go home. Mm-hmm. So when they cut the lights on, we went back in and sit down again.
Okay. Did they serve you all?
Never got served.
Never got served. Oh, my goodness.
This
wow.
was one way to get y'all out of the building.
So we got served.
We actually looked this up. So that meant you went to the schools to galvanize teams from both of our now historically black high schools.
Right.
It was a Monday.
Right.
February 29th, 1960 was a Monday.
Right.
So that means the students were out of school.
Now, what happened, they met me at the church.
At
St. Paul AME Church. And that's when we marched downtown.
So was this during lunchtime?
No, it was in the afternoon.
Okay.
It was in the afternoon.
After school.
After school.
Okay.
After school, right.
Now, were the principals African-American?
Yes.
Oh, at that time?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, wonderful. Yeah. Well, this is a real true history lesson for me because when this occurred, I wasn't even born. So it's an honor to sit here
Absolutely.
Next to you to hear this history firsthand, you know. So thank you so much for coming today.
Thank you.
I know we're going to get back to the sit-in, but we want our viewing audience to really get to know the man. Mm-hmm. So you talked about you were 21 years old, president in high school, NAACP president, working very, very closely with the Honorable Dr. Leon Laurie, who pastored one of the oldest churches in Tampa Bay, and that's Beulah Baptist Institutional Church in West Tampa. So now, you're in the sit-in, you were single, Were you dating?
I was dating.
Oh, okay. Would that be?
My wife, Yvonne, okay. She was attending.
That was a true ride and die, right?
She was attending Gibbs Junior College, believe it or not, in St. Petersburg.
Oh, my goodness. Right. Oh, okay.
And she used to get off of the bus and come and participate in the sit-ins.
Wow. Now, that's a love story right there. Because, right. You know, today we would be saying, that Negro is crazy. Meet me afterwards.
Yeah.
But, wow. Now, that's a love story.
No, she actually participated in the sit-ins, right.
So she was there with you from the sit-in, and she's still sitting at the dinner table with you today?
Absolutely.
Wow. How many years?
60 years.
Oh, 60 years. Wow.
So then that married, means you, congratulations. So you got married shortly after
December 31st, 1960.
Ooh, wow.
December 31st, 1960.
Just a few months after the sit-in. Congratulations. Yeah, that in itself is a show in and of itself. Was she afraid for you?
No, not really. You know, young people wasn't afraid back then. Okay. We really wasn't afraid right
now. Okay. So you go through this, and how many days did you all actually do this? Do the
sit-in? We sit in for about 5 days.
Oh,
wait. And then that's when we got the call to back off and let the city fathers get together. They are appointed a biracial committee.
Okay, so that's what we read about.
He appointed a biracial committee, and I was assured. I had a meeting. I was able to meet with some of the mayor's staff and one or two of our adults, and they asked me. We would just hold off. We'd try and find a peaceful way to integrate the stores.
So in 5 days, you come back every day.
Yes.
In any one of those 5 days, did they feed you?
No. Let's close the lunch counters.
Just shut them down every day.
And like I said, we didn't have money to buy anything anyway. They didn't.
Right. So they lost money as well.
Well, so, we knew they weren't going to serve us. So,
right. So the mayor appoints a biracial committee.
Right.
Do you have any idea who served on that committee?
Well, I know James Hebben was one.
Hebben name just keeps coming up. And you know we're on James Hebben campus. He's one of the founders of the Tampa Hillsborough Action Plan.
Yeah, Robin Laurie, of course. Laurie. There was a Robin Bansfield. He was a minister of a holiness church, if I'm not mistaken, and several other ministers around town.
Okay, so were they all African-Americans?
All African-Americans.
Okay.
All African-Americans. Then they had a couple of businessmen. They had I don't know if he was the owner or he was a manager of the old Mars Brothers.
I remember Mars Brothers. Yeah, that was like downtown. A couple of blocks away going south.
And there was a gentleman over the, the shipping outfit in Tampa by the name of Robert Thomas. And they were all movers and shakers in Tampa.
Well, let me ask you this. When you did the sit-in, I know you were doing it because you felt that was that's something that needed to be done. Did you ever realize, ever think that I'm going to live to see a change, a significant change, that I would be a legacy member, a historian, someone that folks are going to look up to? Did you ever think of that when you were doing that?
No.
Wow.
Never did. Never
so how do you feel now knowing that, you know, we are so in awe of you and we thank you so much and that you're going to live in history books forever? How does that feel?
Well, it just makes me feel good because I had a chance to help change history. And not only that, but my kids, grandkids.
Well, you got to shout your kids out.
Yes.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit. Who are your kids?
Well, my son, it's Ken John, and my daughter's Angelita. She's the oldest. And she graduated from Clark Atlanta. My son from Morehouse, and then from Harry Medical College.
Congratulations!
That's awesome.
Let me ask you this: how do you, or did you even envision that in a Trump presidency, we still need the kinds of actions that you took 40, 50 years ago? 60 years ago, did you ever envision it? We'd still need that kind of an action.
No, I didn't. I think what happened after we got to a certain point, we became complacent.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And we just backed off of everything, and whatever was given us, we just took it. But when I look at the political situation today, it saddens me. To think that we are turning the clock back.
What would be your recommendation to young people now?
Great question.
Vote.
Great question.
Vote.
Vote.
The
importance of their vote.
To learn what's happening in America on the political scene and take a part in organizing.
Organizing.
Mm-hmm. And getting together and trying to get the vote out. You know, that's how we actually elected Obama. I don't know if you remember when he was running.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, you people were everywhere.
Yeah.
Well, there were also some funding that came down from Howard University that made sure we galvanized the right people. And it's interesting that you say that, because I was having a conversation with Sheikh Washington, former principal of Middleton High School.
Right.
And we were talking about February the 18th was the last day to register for the general election to be able to participate in the presidential election. But yet we didn't hear much about it. And I said, wow, that's a very, very important date. I can remember when voters would be wrapped around the buildings just to be able to get in and to register. So to hear you use a term like complacency, it just breaks your heart. It breaks your heart. So we're there. I just have another question about the sitting, and we want to move on because Aldiva asked a question about your legacy. So we started off the show. We wanted to talk about the man. We wanted to talk about the movement. We also wanted to come back and talk about the memories. And so I'm looking at what you have on today, and your shirt says Clarence Fort Freedom Trail, and your hat says Freedom Trail, Tampa, Florida. So we want to find out what exactly does that mean. And I'll share these pictures. I shared it with DJ CEO, but on this picture, you'll get to see the pictures, but that's Perry Harvey, and that's Jim Hamlin. And so both of them made pivotal strides. And the lady that's on the end, Mr. Fort, who is the young lady that's right here?
Let me say it again. Her name was Lucine Williams. She was worked in the Tampa housing projects off of Florida Avenue. She was one of the coordinators for youth programs.
So you all can see from the 1960 picture, you can see that years later, they're now able to sit down, and there's a Caucasian woman that's serving them.
Wow.
I wonder if they ever integrated the employees.
Well, let me tell you about the intergenerational things. You're saying Perry Harvey's is in that picture. His grandson is one of my Facebook friends, J. Oscar Simmons, who's an actor.
I know that.
Yeah, so hopefully Oscar, who went to school with me at FAMU, hopefully you're listening and you're seeing that.
Well, we're global, so if not, we'll certainly be able to tag him on your Facebook page.
Yes, because, and he's very proud of his grandfather.
That's history in and of itself, if you look to see what he did. There's another picture I have, and this picture is the two of you, a picture of Mr. Fort and Dr. Laurie, and this is years later. They're marching at Woolworth at the sit-in. So now they're outside. I think on this picture, Woolworth is now gone. It was just a building. The store was there for many, many years, but no longer. And look at all the camera people out there. Again, those persons. And then there's another picture, and you can share with us. But what I wanted to, and what I wanted our radio listening audience to know, as a result of this sit-in, there were a number of things that happened in doing research on you. You were invited to the White House.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Who made that happen? How did that come about?
Well, what happened, I spoke at the in St. Paul, Minnesota, at the NAACP convention. I was a youth speaker for that convention we had.
Wow.
As a result of that, someone heard about it, and they sent tickets. So I was able to speak before the Civil Rights Commission.
Oh, my goodness.
I was invited by Kennedy's brother, Robert Kennedy.
Robert Kennedy invites you to White House.
Some men see things as they are and say, why? I see things that never were and say, why not?
Why not?
Robert Kennedy.
Wow. So that was quite an experience.
You're not going to go ahead and ask what your countrymen can do for you? You're on a roll with the Kennedys. So, and listening to Alana earlier, how many years after the sit-in were you invited to the White House?
Oh, it was 1 year after it was right during the time.
During that time, so 61, that time, somewhere right. in there.
Right.
While we were trying to get the Civil Rights Act passed, this was kind of like putting all of that in motion, taking us to 60, 61, 62, then finally 63. And then to hear Alana call in so many years later, you take a group of young people on a bus.
Yes, we did.
They ride the bus to Washington.
We did a civil rights tour first.
Okay.
And we started out in Little Rock, Arkansas.
Man.
We went to Memphis, Tennessee. We came this one.
And
we ended up in Birmingham, Alabama.
Wow.
And we went to all of the significant places, states. The civil rights tour.
Significant civil rights states.
Right. Right.
And so then you take this group on to Washington, D.C. I remember, I think maybe it was Jim Davis, and I saw this.
Right. This picture. He carried the kids down on the Florida Senate.
Wow.
The House of Representatives.
On the floor.
Right, on the floor of the House of Representatives, the kids, right?
And that was really fun. Jim Davis, right. And do some things. And this is why it's important to get to know your political leaders and really, really get to know them. Mm-hmm. So when you need to make some things happen, and I always go back, Mr. James Hammond is always my go-to person because he's the one that will call a senator, call a congressman.
Yes.
And matter of fact, they flew him to Washington. And here you get an invitation to Washington. And both of you were sitting at the counter at Woolworth.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So we come here. The store is no longer there. Closes many, many years ago. And after, almost, 55 years, they finally, maybe closer to 60 years, there's a marker, 801 Franklin Street. A beautiful marker. There's a picture of you, Arthena Joyner, Bob Buckhorn, former Mayor Bob Buckhorn, Commissioner Les Miller, and I think three other classmates were in that picture as well. And we have the picture. We'll tag the picture. But there you are, and that's the memory. You ask, well, what's part of his legacy? What's his legacy? What's been left? That is there. And I believe on the back, I read to you what was inscribed on the front. I believe the back actually lists the students,
right.
Some of the students from Blake and from Middleton. And really, honestly, we should be there on the 29th. 60 years, they did to make this happen so that we could go into Woolworths. I remember my mom taking us, there were like two stores, and so we go into that back entrance. And I remember she was a seamstress, so she made all of our clothes. And fabric was, she could get 4 yards of fabric for a dollar.
Wow.
Yeah, there were 8 of us, so she needed that help. And so, but here's the thing. To now know that we finally got to go in that store and they valued our money. It was the same green money.
Yes.
It's the same money that you put in the bank.
Yes.
But it meant that our money was not worth anything. So they didn't even want us in the store. So now you're able to go there. We have this. But what are we doing to make sure that the stories are being told? What are we doing to make sure that people are actually visiting this landmark? Yes. That's what it is.
Yes, yes.
It's a landmark. And I'm going to tell you, I already called one of the news stations because I said, 60 years and we're not hearing anything about this?
Good for you.
Then we have to do our part.
Yes.
We weren't there.
Right.
But we can certainly make sure that, you know, our children definitely know about it. So we go there. If you got the Facebook flyer, you saw another picture. And right here in East Tampa on Osborne Avenue, in between, is that 34?
30th Street.
30th Street.
Osborne and 30th.
Now, so check this out. So he goes to Middleton High School, galvanized the students from there. You can stand on the corner of Middleton High School and see this park. And the park, what's the name of the park, sir?
Clarence Fort Freedom Trail.
Oh, wow.
Actually,
Clarence Fort Freedom Trail. Congratulations.
The mayor let me name it, so.
Freedom Trail.
I have this park.
I would name it the same thing.
I want you to ride out and take a look at it and see what you're thinking about it. And if you like it, let me know. So I told him it was fine. He said, well, what do you want to name it? I said, well, it's going to be my park. Name it after me.
Yes. So Clarence Fort Freedom Trail. And right. It's interesting on your hat is just the Freedom Trail.
Where's
so
this
if you
located?
Haven't had a chance, you know where Middleton High School is?
Uh-huh.
Okay, it's right on Osborne Avenue.
Osborne,
and
okay.
And that would be between
East from Middleton.
29th and 30th.
Okay, definitely.
So you can see it if you're on the corner of the campus of Middleton's property. You can actually see the park. And so that was named in your honor. We've got the landmark of the marker that's on 801 Franklin Street. And not just you, all of those. Arthenia Joyner was there at the actual sit-in. Today we have a library named after her. And there's so many things named after Dr. Leon Lowry. He also has has a school and there are other buildings that his name is etched there. There are so many other questions, but I wanted to ask you, who are you passing this baton to?
Well, the only thing I was able to do with the Saving Our Children program, I passed it down to them. And as far as civil rights, things had opened up so much, so there wasn't really a need to demonstrate and do this type things now. So it's mostly educational, trying to get them to get
the game's changed education. A little bit.
Right.
It seems the civil rights movement, there were multiple components to it, but it seemed like the portion that got the most traction and results was that part as far as equal rights for voting. But there was the economic piece. There was the piece with housing and health care. And it seems like we're still fighting for that equality today. And I heard you say earlier, we the people have become complacent. I love some of the people who are running for office today. I love some of the millennials that are running for office today. And they're saying, hey, it's time for us to do something. It's time for us to speak up. You're saying you share your legacy with the 400 kids that you taught this history to. We certainly heard one of them call in and explain that. We heard Mrs. Jennings say earlier that you were a leader all the way from elementary school. As we come to the end of this show, and as I said, there'll be part two. My heart is part of my heart is excited to have the conversation with you while you're living, and to be able to hear you say the things that you said. For 5 days, you sat in a counter, and for 5 days, you could not eat. Lights were turned off. You were put out of the building, and there's a marker. No bigger than probably about, I don't know, maybe it stands 5 feet high, but it's probably no wider than maybe a couple of feet, DJ CEO. But that's what we have to remember what all of those lives, over 40 students, the members that came with you all, that's what we have to remember what happened at Woolworth.
Wow. It's amazing. We have a living legend.
A living legend. Absolutely.
Here in the studio with us. That's amazing. Thank you so much. I'm not sure how much time we have left.
It's about all.
Okay, so is it done?
Now we get a call. We are just about out of time, but we do have a call. Caller, come in.
Hello.
Okay. Is that DJ
CEO?
Can
you hear me? Oh, okay. It's not DJ CEO. We can hear you. Who are you? Who's calling?
My name is Yana Kuso.
Oh, good.
Calling in.
Okay.
Deacon Ford, that's Yannick Cousseau on the phone.
Hello, Yannick. How are you?
He's not my Facebook friend.
I'm good. How are you?
I'm Brian. I'm fine. Good to hear your voice.
Same to you. It's been a while.
Yannick Cousseau, we are at the end of the show. So you just, if there's something that you want to say to Mr. Ford, you've got a couple of seconds to get it in.
First off, I just want to start off by saying thank you for the guidance and the knowledge that you provided me through me and my childhood friends as we grew from young men into adulthood. I tell people all the time whenever I'm traveling throughout in and out of states. Recently, just got back from Louisiana and we made a detour. We drove from Ohio to Louisiana, then from Louisiana to Atlanta, and just driving through those states in the South. And I was talking to the individual in my car, and I said, you know, every time I'm down here, I'm always reminded of the bus trips that Saving Our Children program took us through, and the civil rights portions that we got to experience. And I tell people all the time that experience as a teenager just seeing that and the feeling that I felt is something that I'll always cherish with me for the rest of my life. And so I finally got the opportunity just to tell you thank you for you and the rest of the leaders of the Save Our Children program that gave me that experience as a teenager.
Well, thank you, Yannick. I'm glad we could share that knowledge with you. You guys were great back in those days. I always tell everybody that it's so sad that we ended the program a couple of years ago after 30 years, but I just like to thank everyone for even having the opportunity to work with the young people.
Awesome.
In that length of time.
Well, Mr. Cusso, thank you so much for calling in. We appreciate you taking the time to do it. We are out of time. We are going to have part two to this show, but for now, so we thank you so much. We do want to say thank you. Thank you. As Alana said, Deacon Mr. Clarence Ford.
Thank you so
for
much.
For blazing the trail for us.
Yes.
For you and Dr. Laurie and all of those that played such an integral role in getting us to where we are today. There's still a lot to be done. You talked about your legacy. And I asked you, do you have a book?
I'm working on it.
Working on it, okay.
On the book. What's the name of your book going to be, sir?
The Sit Down That Changed Tampa.
We'll definitely have you back for the book. That's a great title. And so you heard it first right here on In Touch News Radio. Let's Talk Business with SJC. I'm here with my co-host, L Diva. We thank you so much
to all
of you that took the time out from your busy schedule. If you had a comment, we'll answer you after the show. It's only an hour. And so we thank you so much. But this weekend, and we'll see if maybe we can get Mr. Ford and join him and go down to that marker and celebrate the 60th anniversary of the Woolworth sit-in. It's worth it to us to get up and do something to remember this and teach our children what people did so that today we can go in stores and shop and spend our money because it has the same value as anybody else's money.
Yes.
Well, that's a wrap.
That's a wrap.